Hi, I'm Russell Skews, service training instructor for Case IH Combines in North America, and today we're going to talk about 3162 TerraFlex headers and the setup and operations of the headers. We're going to start here on the feeder opening, and before you match this up with a combine, you want to make sure that we get these stripper plates set for the correct machine that we're going to connect this to. So there's two sets of stripper plates. There's a set of stripper plates for a mid-range combine, which will bring the feeder opening narrower. And then there's a different set of stripper plates that we would put in here for the wider feeder opening for a flagship. And these would have to be removed and the new stripper plates installed in the position right here. Next thing we'll talk about on the feeder opening here is the auger. And the auger has some flight extensions on it and some fingers, just like any other auger that we have on a grain platform or the draper head. And the flight extensions are set up here to feed the opening. And if you get in a really big, bulky crop and you want to feed a flagship, which has got a wider opening than this, this one is set up for a mid-range, we could take off this first set of flight extensions and make a wider feeder opening to allow a larger crop mat to go up into the combine. Or if we find that we're in a very light crop that doesn't have a lot of bulk to it, we can add another set of flight extensions to this auger and bring that crop mat in so it builds a pile bigger and have better, smoother, even feeding. We can also adjust the height of the auger. It is adjustable up and down, so we could set this down if we had a very light crop, or if someone had set it down lower and we wanted to bring it up to allow a bigger and bulkier crop in there, we could do that as well. And finally, we do have fingers and finger timing, and like all of our heads, on the right-hand end, we can make the adjustment for the finger timing. Typically, we want the fingers to be extended fully at the 10 o'clock position and retracted at the 4 o'clock position, but we can adjust that a little bit depending on the size of the crop mat to make sure we get a nice, smooth, even transition from the auger into the combine. Okay, so to summarize what we've just talked about in this area here, we've got stripper plates that we can set up for mid-range or flagship. We've got auger height that we can adjust. We have auger flight extensions that we can adjust. We have auger finger timing that we can adjust. So those are the items that you want to adjust in the back sheet area here. One of the other things we want to check before we head to the field is we want to check the side draper belt tension. And that is done in this region right here. And you will notice that there is an indicator right down in here. And the indicator will tell us the tension on the side draper belts. There's a little red indicator on the inside, and we need it to be in the middle of the slot. If it's not in the middle of the slot, we'll want to use our large bolt here, and we want it to go clockwise to make it tighter, counterclockwise to make it looser. But we want the indicator to be in the center of the slot right there, and that will give us the proper belt tension. We have one on the right and one on the left. We're showing you the one on the right end of the header, but you'll have another one on the left end that will look exactly the same way. Okay, one of the other things we want to do is we want to make sure that we have the proper fluid levels. So we have a hydraulic oil reservoir sight gauge right here. That must be completely full. We have a second hydraulic oil reservoir sight gauge on the overflow tank, and we want to just make sure that that's in the middle or somewhere in the middle of the range on the sight glass up in here. And then lastly, we want to just check here our gear chain and make sure that we got oil on that sight glass as well. Okay, on our valve block here, we have a couple of flow control adjustments here. The top one is for our knife speed. And if I turn the flow control counterclockwise, that will make the knife go faster. And we really want a fairly fast knife speed to make sure we can cut those plants off nice and clean. There might be a condition where you get some shattering with a faster knife speed that you might want to slow this down, but for the most part, we're going to want to have this knife running about as fast as we can. So again, fully counterclockwise or fully open on the flow control will make the knife run as fast as it can. The other one that's on the valve body here is going to be our side draper speed. So that's the lower one. And again, if I turn it counterclockwise, the side drapers will go faster. If I turn it clockwise, the side drapers will go slower. What I'm trying to achieve with my side draper speed is I want the two piles to just merge in the middle of this head and move right up into the feeder house. If I have it going too slow, I'll have two distinct piles going up the feeder house, which may not be fully utilizing the capacity of our machine. And if I have it going too fast, I will have two piles merging and making a pile that does not feed well. We want to make sure that we have that heads first feeding and everything's moving smooth and even up into the feeder house. So too slow, you'll have two separate piles. and you're not fully utilizing the full width of the feeder too fast, and they'll have a big pile in the middle. They'll pooch up like this, and we don't want that either. We want the two piles to, or the two sides to come straight together like this and move right up the feeder house. The other thing when you get this too fast is if you're only taking a portion of the head, what can happen is one side of the draper can overshoot into the other draper belt. We don't want that to happen. We want it to land in the middle and feed. Even if we take a half a head or a portion of a head, we want to make sure that that lands in the middle and moves right up the feeder house. We're going to talk about our row dividers. There's two different row dividers. There's this medium row divider with or without the rod. You can take the rod off if you want to just remove a couple of bolts and pull it right out if you thought that that was impacting your field conditions. But typically they're going to be on, and this is the medium divider. And we want the medium divider to be low enough to separate that crop and to start that feeding onto our cutter bar and keep the crop that we're not cutting away from the side of the head. And there are some adjustments to the height of this in here. There's a couple of bolts you can loosen and raise this up or lower this down in order so that we get it at a height that's appropriate for the size of the crop that we're cutting. Now there is a long divider as well, and a long divider would put another one of these out on the end. And when we get that, then we want to make sure that we get this height adjusted properly, and there's a spring in here that will also help to bias this so that we make sure that this doesn't drag into the ground. So that would be much like a 30-20 head, the same type of adjustments that we have there. But we want to just make sure that the row divider is close enough to the ground to do the dividing, but not so low to the ground that it's going to cause pushing or digging when we're in the field. Okay, like most of our reels, this has a minimum reel height setting right here, and we want to make sure that when the reel is all the way down and positioned over the cutter bar, that the reel tines will not get into the cutter bar. And we just want to make sure that that has been set properly so that we don't cut our tines off with our cutter bar. Okay, so before we go to the field, we're going to want to unlock our cutter bar, and we're going to do that with the pins. When the cutter bar is locked up in the rigid position, the pins are in the forward hole, and we want to remove the pins and move them to the second hole back here. So we'll just pull the pin out, and sometimes you'll have to lift up on the cutter bar in order to get the pin out. This one happens to have the in-cab flotation adjust, and we've got the cutter bar sucked all the way up with that. So it allows us to move the pin out pretty easily. So I'm just going to move it to the second hole and reinstall it, and the cutter bar will be unlocked. Now I have to do this on every runner, so it depends on the width of the header as to how many of these I'll have to do, but obviously start on one end and work your way all the way to the other end, just pulling the pins and moving them back to unlock the cutter bar. This particular head has the in-cab flotation adjust for our TerraFlex, and we've got turnbuckles on each one of our runners, which will set the preload on each one of our TerraFlex blocks. We want to make sure that the cutter bar has the same flotation all the way across it, so each one of the runners can be adjusted independently if necessary. So we would check the flotation, and then if need be, we would adjust the turnbuckle appropriately to get the right amount of bias on our runner here for our TerraFlex block. Okay, now we have our cutter bar unlocked. What we want to do is we want to check the preload on the flotation system. It's going to be a little bit different if you have the in-cab adjust versus the manual adjust on the back of the head. But you see we have the header positioned about a foot off the ground. And basically what you want to do is you just want to kind of put your foot on the cutter bar and push down and see if you have any bias or preload on that cutter bar at all. Now because this is the in-cab adjust, if we completely relax this thing off, we want to make sure that we are about as heavy as we possibly could be. But the other key point is that we want to be even across this cutter bar, because if we make a change with our in-cab flotation system, we want it to change all the way across the cutter bar, not certain portions of it. So right here, we've got a cutter bar that is completely relaxed and we have no preload on it. And we'd want to make sure that we go all the way down the cutter bar and that all of it, all the runners are adjusted similarly along the edge. Now, if this was a manual adjust cutter bar, we'd want to make sure that we had some preload on this before we went to the field, so that we would not be setting very heavily on the field, especially as the conditions get softer or wetter. You want to have some preload on that, and those adjustments would be made on the back of the head. With the in-cab adjust, it's going to be slightly different. As you see here, we've got no preload on this cutter bar whatsoever. Okay, one of the other things we want to do before we head to the field is we want to check the oil level in our Centra Cut knife drive. So we've got an access cover here. So we'll remove the bolts and take the access cover off, and our center cut knife drive is right down here. We do have a sight glass that you can look at. The header does need to be on the ground in order to get an accurate reading on the sight glass. Okay, so to check minimum reel height, we're going to want to set the cutter bar on the ground to get the knife to come all the way up. And we're going to want to move our reel fore and aft and up and down, down all the way, and then move back and forth, fore and aft, until we get centered over the cutter bar. We want to make sure that we have plenty of clearance between our tine knives and our cutter bar. You could also put a 4 or 6 inch block under the cutter bar and raise it up a little bit to simulate going over an object in the field, and bring that cutter bar up a little bit farther to make sure that your tines will not get into your cutter bar. Okay, all of these heads are equipped with cam action reels, and they work with a cam track and some cam followers. And we want to ensure during the first several hundred hours of operation that these cam followers are indeed followers. So you see here, this is set up so the fingers are out here and the cam follower is the roller, the item back here. We want to make sure that that is lagging. So as the reel comes around, this needs to be behind. Every now and then the setup guys may get one of these reversed when they flip these tine bars over, or on occasion they do flip on their own, and you want to make sure that these are following, because that would put your fingers into a bind and they don't want to roll over nice and even then. So just make sure that your cam followers are indeed following behind your tines. Okay, so one of the things you want to just quickly check is your reel drive chain. So we're just going to open the cover on the reel drive chain and just make sure that the chain has the proper tension. Obviously, if it's too loose or too tight, it's not going to drive properly. And you can tension this with the draw bolt on the end. Loosen a couple of bolts on the motor to allow the motor to slide back and forth, and use the draw bolt to properly tension the chain. One of the other things we want to check is we want to check the center draper belt tension. And if we need to adjust that or the tracking, that will be done underneath the center section of the head here. So we have two center draper belts, a left and a right. Each of them have two adjustments, one on the left and one on the right, and each of them are done with a draw bolt. And there's going to be a bracket underneath here. We want the intersection and the outer section to be level with each other, and that will tell us that we've got the right tension on it. And if we had to do some tracking, we could by adjusting one side just a little bit differently from the other. So we've done our pre-checks, and we got our head set up outside. We've now connected it to the combine. We've moved inside the cab, and we're happen to be on a mid-range here, going to have similar things for a flagship, but we just want to make sure that the combine is set up for this head. So on a mid-range, we're going to go back, and we're going to go into the toolbox, and then on a mid-range, we're going to go into the head two. We would do the same thing on the head one on a flagship. But you see here, the header type sensor has recognized this as a draper head, and we currently have it set as a Flex 3000 series draper grain header. And that would enable all of the features that we have on these 3000 series Flex drapers or draper heads in general. Reel drive type of 7 is correct for this head. It has the reel drive ratio that's set up for this reel drive type, so that's fine. If you had reel position sensors on your head and you wanted to use them, you could turn them on right here. But that's the minimum that we need to set up on the head 2 screen to make sure that all of the functions are going to work. Okay, so one of the first things we want to set is we want to set the knife angle. And the knife angle indicator is currently in the middle of travel, which is really where we want to start. Now, if it wasn't in the middle of travel, we would use the shift button, and again, we're in a mid-range, so you hear the beep. So there's my shift button, and then I'll use the reel fore and aft control, and you can see here that the knife angle is getting very steep, and then if I go the opposite way, I'm going to get a knife angle that's very shallow. Now, in different ground conditions, we might want to rock that head back, or if it's rocky, we might want to rock that head back to make sure that the cutter bar would float up and over any obstructions that are in the field. Or if we have low potted crops, we may want to be beyond center. But for the most part, we kind of want to start right in the middle of the knife travel, and that's a good place to start right there. So the indicator is in the middle of travel. The big circle in the center shows you that, and that's where we'd like to start. Okay, one of the other things we have to do on a mid-range combine is we're going to have to do a ground cal. Now, if this was on a flagship, our header calibration would have to be performed, but we're going to go ahead and do a ground cal because we are sitting in a mid-range combine. So to perform the ground cow, the feeder must be off, and I'm going to lower the head all the way to the ground and hold the down button for a count of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And I'm going to release the down button and press and hold the raise button. And you'll see the head come up off the ground about a foot and stop. And then it's going to continue on up to the top end of travel. And what I just did is I calibrated my header height sensors, so the combine now knows the full rotation of my header height sensors. Okay, one of the other things we want to do, because this particular head has the in-cab flotation adjust, is we'd like to set our flotation to the middle of the range. And we're going to do that with the shift button. And again, because we're in a mid-range, you'll hear a beep. So here's the shift. And we're going to use the real raise and lower in order to change the flotation adjust. And we're just going to hang on to it here until we see that indicator come just about to the 3. And you can see we're just passing through the 4. And we're going to go just inside the 4. And that's kind of going to put us in the middle of our flotation adjust range. And that's kind of where we want to start. Now, if the soils are firm, we can go a little bit heavier, which would be towards the 5-6 side. And if we want to go a little bit lighter, if the soils are soft or the ground conditions are such that we're pushing soybean stems or leaves, then we can get a little bit lighter yet. Or if we happen to have a no-till situation where we've got some corn stalks or corn root balls or that sort of thing that we need to float up and over, we can make the cutter bar lighter. And again, it's going to be shift and real raise and lower to do that. Okay, so now we're going to set our automatic header height control system to operate in the middle of its travel. So we must first turn on the separator, and we're going to turn on the feeder. Now with the separator and the feeder on, what we want to do is we want to lower the header down until our header height indicator is in the middle of the range. And you see the indicator there is pointing to the black area. And there's one of these on the right and one of these on the left. So we want to use the terrain tracker, the lateral tilt system, as well as the header height system in order to position our header in the middle of the travel range so that the indicator is pointing to the black on both ends of the head. Once we have it set so that they're in the black on both ends of the head, we're going to push set point number 1 to store that height. It doesn't really matter if you push 1 or 2, but we're going to use number 1. And it has now stored that as set point number 1. Okay. Now, when I'm cutting soybeans, I like to set a second height to cut. And my second height to cut, I like to just bring the cutter bar a little bit up off the ground so that I could clear some rocks. And so I'm going to go ahead and set a second height to cut here that's just off the ground to clear up and over any big rocks that we might have in the field. So I'll set 2. And then the last thing I need to do is I need to set a turn height. So what I'm going to do is raise the header up until I get to my turn height. And now I'm going to go into the display and set my maximum working height. So to set my maximum work height, I've got my cutter bar where I want the max work height to be. I'm going to go back, I'm going to go into the toolbox, and I'm going to go into the head 1 screen, and I've got this box up here at the top that says maximum working height. And what I'm going to do is touch the box, and I'm going to push cal. So now it's caled it, so this is going to be my maximum working height, and I'm going to press enter. So now this is where my turn height is going to be, and this is also going to be where my acre counter will turn itself on and off. Okay, so now we've got our 2 heights of cut set, we've got our turn height set, so now all I have to do is hit the resume button, and it'll go to one of my 2 cutting heights, and right now we're set for the off the ground cutting height, which would be for clearing that rock or whatever. I'll hit the resume button again, and it takes me down to my working height. So this is going to be my height to cut here as I cut my soybeans. If I need to, I can adjust my height to cut. And my indicators have moved down a little bit, so I'm going to increase the height of cut here a little bit. So I'm going to just push and hold the raise button a little bit, get myself back into the black areas on both of my indicators. And now we're good to go on header height. So far we've set our knife angle, we've set our flotation adjust, we've done a ground cow, we've set 2 heights of cut and a turn height. And now if I was combining through the field and I came to a rock, I would simply hit resume and we pick the cutter bar up and over the rock. and then I could hit resume, go right back down to my cut position. The other thing we'll have to talk about is reel, and we have three adjustments that we can make from the seat here. We can set our reel height. So we want the reel to hit the crop about a third of the way down and sweep that off the cutter bar if we can. So you can use the reel raise and lower switches on the multifunction handle to set the reel height. The other thing we can do is we can set the reel fore and aft position. So you can see here I'm sending the reel out. So either the reel fore or the reel aft, bringing it back. And we're going to have to fine-tune this as we're going through the field. And really what we want that reel to do is we want that reel to hold that crop and to just tip it back onto the draper belt so that we get a nice, smooth, even flow of material across that knife and onto that draper belt. The other thing we can adjust is our reel speed. And typically we would either run in manual reel speed or automatic reel speed. And if we're on manual reel speed, we're going to use the control on the side, the right-hand console here, and we're going to just simply turn the control up to make the reel faster clockwise or counterclockwise to make it go slower. If we press the top side of the switch, we'll get the little A to illuminate. When the A is illuminated, we're going to be an automatic reel to ground. And then what we're going to be able to do is, as we speed up and slow down the combine, the reel will automatically speed up and slow down with us. Now, the control here on the left then becomes an offset, so I can make the reel go faster at all ground speeds or slower at all ground speeds. The last reel speed control we have is underneath the right-hand armrest. So if we lift up the armrest and we've got the forward control here, this is my minimum reel speed. And this sets when the combine is at zero, which we're filming this at the combine at zero, how fast would the reel turn? And if I turn this all the way down to nothing, that will stop the reel. But if I turn this up a little bit, it will determine, even when the combine is not turning, what is the minimum reel speed? And that's nice for when you're slowed down and cutting around objects, which need to be paid more attention to. It will continue to sweep that material across that cutter bar and help deliver that up onto the draper belt. So we've got minimum reel speed here. Then over on the console, we would have our manual or automatic reel speed mode switch, and then either our manual reel speed control or our automatic reel speed control offset.